have been hearing about Vision India Foundation for the last 6 to 12 months, and was greatly inspired by it, by its vision. And it is such a wonderful coincidence that my trip to India coincided with before the conclusion of your boot camp, and so I'm really delighted to be here, although I did not have an opportunity to interact and much more closely observe. If I had an opportunity, I would have loved to spend a day or two, but at least just to get a glimpse of it and hearing about how the last 18 days have been. In fact, other than Numish Bolia, who initially updated me about the whole thing, one of the very close friends, Dr. R. Balasubramaniam, probably, who was here with you at the inaugural time, and again is going to be there at the conclusion time, we spent almost a day or so together in Los Angeles, and listening to him also, his passion about mission building in general and initiative like Vision India Foundation was also very compelling and very touching. Let me just, in the interest of the time, maybe take about 10 minutes or so to give some broad overview of policy-related possibilities and opportunities in the American universities, and then maybe we can open up some question answers. Just I'll make a few comments for you to think about, just to stimulate your thinking. In the American university system, there are three broad categories of universities. There are some very distinguished private universities like Harvard, Stanford, Yale, Columbia, etc. And then there are public-funded universities, like University of California is a system of 10 very well-known major universities in 10 cities, or State University of New York, or what is called SUNY, State University of New York, Buffalo, New York, Stony Brook, etc., etc. Like similarly, University of Michigan, University of Texas, that is another public-funded universities. There is an interesting third category, which is probably not there in this country. They are called School of Divinity or Theological Universities. There are close to about 200 such universities, and they try to teach about religion in an academic sense. And the ministers and the pastors and the chaplains and the non-profit organizations leaders who are sensitive in religious issues and also are able to work in the public domain. There is a very interesting third category. Although there is a separation of religion and state, as in India and US also, but there is a high respectability for a systematic academic study of religion. In fact, one of the major professional bodies called AAR, American Academy of Religion, has some 15,000 members who gather every year, and all the different religions have discussions and dialogues. And I think it's a much more, it gives a different quality of understanding of religion. Anyhow, that's not the more immediate topic. What I would like to say is, in the domain of humanities or social sciences or liberal arts, there seems to be a relative paucity of any original work when it comes to India. Lot of very fashionable ideas and theories and methodologies have arisen since the World War II in Europe, in America, and majority of the institutions in this country have pretty much imitated and followed those models, some of which might have had something worthwhile, some of which may be totally irrelevant, but still in the spirit of a slavish mentality, a sort of copying has occurred. I'll just give you one concrete example. You might have been familiar with the field called area study. Now, what is area study? During the Cold War, United States wanted to understand the different regions of the world in terms of their geopolitical interest, so that they can formulate their policy, the State Department's policy, the Foreign Ministry is called State Department. And accordingly, what are the various ethnicities, what are the geopolitical fault lines, what type of issues need to be kept in mind in order to serve American interest, that became a major objective or motivation for defining this field, and a lot of money was poured into it, and a lot of departments are opened. Now, many of these things are in Indian universities also, area study. Now, for example, when you may be surprised to know that till 1950s and 60s, India was studied in American universities as India study. However, after the area study was introduced, the terminology was shifted to South Asian studies. Now, South Asian study may appear a very benign term, but you know, it is a American way of de-emphasizing the significance of India as a state, nation state. In fact, they tried to do it with China also. They wanted to study China as East Asian study. And China insisted that we are not a small little banana republic. You cannot just club us with some all these different countries. We shall be studied only as China study. And today, majority of the American cities do study as China Studies Department. In fact, China threatened that if any scholar who wants to come to China to do research, etc., we will not issue him the certificate if it is not under China Studies. That type of a confidence and a national clarity or a national policy was probably not there in our leadership. And so, Indians tend to be low, so broad-minded, but which is partly okay, but partly I think what it does is, what are the problems from American point of view in India? For example, the North and South differences, the Punjabi Subha issue, the Northeastern separatism movement, or the Dravidian and Aryan, or the Dalit, all types of what are the problems is the main focus of the study. There is very little thought about what is unique and distinctive that Indian thought, Indian philosophy, Indian worldview, Indian paradigm can contribute to the global discourse. So that is the tragedy, that is the irony. And whatever methodologies do come up, whether it is post-colonial study or post-modern study, subaltern study, Marxist study, a Freudian study, they all may have something good but something problematic too. A intellectual, bold critique of these methodologies and what will really help to capture a deeper understanding of what India is all about. In fact, I think I was in my conversation with R. Balasubramaniam, which again you'll be meeting on the last 2 days. He made a very thought-provoking comment. He said, what Modi ji is talking about development is good, is very important, it has to be done. However, there is another aspect to it. What is the aspect? You might have heard, some of you might have heard, there was a very well-known economic historian by the name Angus Madison. He did about 15 to 20 years of extensive study of all the available data of all the civilizations of the world, and his conclusion was, from the first century after Christ till 19th century, for 1800 years, India on an average occupied 24 to 31% of the world GDP. Between India and China, over 50 to 64% was produced by India and China. And then during the British rule, it declined. By 1947, it declined to 0.4% of the global GDP. And today still we are struggling. We are not much, we are better, definitely we are better. Although China has taken much ahead after the 1980s. So the comment that Balasubramaniam made, that there is something that has to be in the civilizational gene of India that created a society that was able to have such extraordinary economic performance and was able to sustain it for 1800 years. If we as a nation are not able to identify, recognize, and nurture those civilizational genes, then just by imitative methods alone, some type of prosperity and development alone may not be sustainable. And I think you take the example in the domain of communication technology. Maybe there is a technology when telephone, all the wires and etc. Then, then came the satellite technology. So when today somebody is thinking about creating the communication technology infrastructure, they have the benefit, advantage of not having to go through what now has become obsolete, has become outdated, has become not very relevant. So similarly, India, in the domain of policy, in the domain of humanities, can make some very important contribution. You just take this one example. There is a global discourse on a variety of issues. Now there is the issue of, say, the famous book that came out, Huntington's book on the clash of civilization. Now, all the people who are participating in the global discourse about clash of civilization generally seem to belong to those countries or those civilizations which have a tendency to believe that ours is the only way. Now, India has a very distinctive worldview which says there can be multiple ways, as well as. It is not either or-ism, but as well as-ism. So, the truth can be achieved, spirituality can be pursued, religion can be followed by a variety of pathways. There is no need for homogenization. We should celebrate the differences. We should celebrate the variety. But that particular Indic voice is conspicuous by its absence at the global discourse table. So this type of thought leadership, if we have to generate, then we got to create people who can very intelligently critique and thoughtfully and judiciously take what is relevant to our context, our situation, what needs to be modified, what needs to be rejected, what needs to be de novo created within our own context, and not feeling so enamored and so over-impressed by anything, but whether it is an international negotiation or whether it is a transfer of technology or whether it is a methodology or an idea or a framework, how do we develop a certain groundedness in our own cultural and civilizational ethos that we will be able to more critically look at these issues. So that is what is needed. I think I'll just close with, I'm very fond of Dr. Balasubramanian. He went to study at Kennedy School of Public Policy at Harvard. During that time, he was able to share some of the unique experiences he developed through his own work in Mysore or in the tribal India. And he was able to impress upon them that there are multiple other models of leadership also, and of developing some very successful possibilities of a grassroots level non-profit movements. In fact, then they were so impressed that he does claim that Kennedy School is one of the world's prestigious, very well-known school in public policy. He does say that he learned a lot, but he taught them a lot also, so much so that ultimately, the Harvard said that, would you come and teach a course every year? And later on, the Cornell came to know, now he teaches a 6-week course or a very condensed 10 to 12 hours every day, 10-day course, which he's going to do in August, September. So this type of a mindset that India is always has this posture, that knowledge can come any direction, we want to welcome it. However, one of my friends made a joke. He said, yes, indeed, we need to have our mind open. But doesn't mean that your mind is so open that the brain is going to fall out. I think an ability to discriminate, to distinguish, to the nuances and subtleties of any given idea, to be able to see for what worth it is. And so that I think the domain of public policy also, maybe I could not necessarily talk a whole lot about. There are, so what we are, the Dharma Resolution Foundation is establishing endowed chairs in the mainstream American universities. And we would like to create center of excellence whereby there can be some exchange program. Like, for example, one of the first chair we created is at the University of California, Irvine, or UCI, one of the major universities in Los Angeles. So there we are aspiring to create a major India center with some critical mass of about 5 to 6 chairs, so that every serious student or researcher or academician, this could become one of the influential international destination point. So that is the vision we have, with which one chair has happened and a couple more chairs are in the pipeline, and hopefully in the next 2 to 3 years that whole India center should emerge. And that is where then Indic thought and ecology, Indic thought and governance, Indic thought and management, Indic thought and economic order, variety of day-to-day practical problems and challenges of living issues, not just some ancient knowledge, but ancient knowledge as relevant and applicable to today's reality. That type of scholarship, a dharma which has an applied aspect, not only scriptural knowledge, but to be able to, what India and Indic thought has to contribute to the complex global issues, both in the Indian context and in the global context. That is the vision, and that's why I got so excited about the Vision India Foundation. I think such dozens and dozens, innumerable experiments of our creative energy has to emerge, both globally and within India. And in that spirit, in that light, I view, and I think you all are very important participants of shaping this new possibility, so that always just not looking to the government, but with a public initiative also, with a private initiative also, people who would like to not just only looking for some safe government job. You know, when I was a little kid, my father used to say that, you should act in a certain way so that your assurance of for a government job will be there. I said, why would I be so pathetic looking for a government job? And he said, don't be so cocky. I said, no, nothing cocky. I think, why should we only be looking for, the whole world is a wide horizon. So I think Vision India Foundation, no matter where you are, whether you are in a government institution, private institution, there is an immaterial secondary detail, but it's a mindset. The mindset of wanting to accept the challenge and wanting to create a new history for India. And that's what I'm so delighted to be. Thank you. Sorry, I took a little longer time than what was allotted to me. My email address is my first name, Manohar, Manohar, and last name is Shinde, Shinde, manoharshinde@gmail.com. I think probably our some of the key members of the Vision India Foundation also has my email. And if any questions, please feel free. I will be in the process.